In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The brothers and sisters, we gather here this weekend to celebrate the feast of the most holy body and blood of Christ. So, are you hungry? Are you thirsty? Then come to God, who feeds us with the food that will help us to know satisfaction and to know the deepest longings of our heart fulfilled. Come to God in this Mass. Come to God in this moment. Come to God in this prayer. And know of God, feeding us, nourishing us with every grace and every blessing that we need. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries.
Were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us of our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who in this wonderful sacrament have left us a memorial of your passion, grant us, we pray, so to revere the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may always experience in ourselves the fruits of your redemption, who live and reign with God the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
Glorify the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion, for he has strengthened the bars of your gates. He has blessed your children within you.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
He has granted peace in your borders. The best of wheat he fills you. He sends forth his command to the earth. Swiftly runs his word.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
He has proclaimed his word to Jacob, his statutes and his ordinances to Israel. He has not done thus for any other nation. His ordinances he has not made known to them. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
First letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, the cup of blessing that we bless is not a participation in the blood of Christ. The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because the loaf of bread is one. We, though many, are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The word of the Lord. Thanks to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
I am the living bread that came down from heaven, says the Lord. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. Alleluia,
alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to the Jewish crowds, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. The Jews quarreled among themselves, saying, How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, Amen, amen, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the man, Son of Man, and drink his blood, you do not have life within you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him on the last day. My flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me, and I have life because of the Father, so also the one who feeds on me will have life because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Unlike your ancestors who ate and still died, whoever eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So I'd imagine by now, you all know that I like literature. I was an English major in college. I like to read. I love stories, and I even like to write. Even though writing doesn't necessarily like me, because it can be difficult. But I have to say that I love stories where there are two parallel universes going on at the same time. You know, there are two worlds that are coexisting along side by side together. Usually in these stories, one world is usually hidden and anonymous, except for maybe to a select few, or maybe to a population of citizens. And then the other world is what we all know, everyday living, the usual world of our life. And I love this kind of a story where these two worlds are going on side by side, because I think there is some value and even some truth to it in reality. So what do I mean? And I hear in the back of my mind my old spiritual director would say, Thomas, concretize this. So make this concrete. So we see this in stories all the time, right? We see these two worlds working side by side in stories all the time. So the obvious stories that at least come to my mind would be stories from like Tolkien, like the Hobbit or the Lord of the Rings series. You know, we have two worlds that are going on together. There is the world of good, like where the good hobbits, where they live in a shire, where they go about their day-to-day living. They live together. So we have those who do this, who fight the looming sickness and tension. We have good wizards, and we have good wizards who will sacrifice life and limb. We have honorable friendships between good groups of hobbits and dwarves. And one of the greatest friendships in all of literature, Sam and Frodo, from these stories of Tolkien, who really, they give up everything. They go to the ends of the earth to not only sacrifice the self for the other, but to sacrifice everything they love to save what they love for those whom they love. And the crazy thing is, everything back in their home, everything back in their hometown, in their shire, nobody has any idea. They are totally clueless that Frodo and Sam are even doing this. They have no idea that there is a danger that's looming. They have no idea of a danger that their own neighbors are thwarting. They just simply continue to live fat and happy in their everyday dealings. We even see this in more current books like the Harry Potter series, whatever you think about Harry Potter. There's all sorts of opinions about these series. But it's going on here as well. In these books, there are two worlds that are coexisting side by side. The world of muggles, which are non-magic people, and the world of wizards and whatnot, people who invoke magic. In one world, the non-magic world, knows nothing of the magic world. They don't even know that it exists. And yet, they coexist. They actually have an impact on each other, directly and indirectly. And even one world unknowingly overcomes the evil in both worlds. They're stories. They're good stories. But it is said that art, the art of literature, reflects the art of real living. And so it does. I don't know about you, but I feel like I have been living in two worlds. One world being anonymous and hidden, and the other world being what we live from day to day. In the day-to-day world, I have become more heightened and more aware of people around me, especially here on the grounds. You know, I'm aware of people who are walking around, people who are running outside, rollerblading even. I drive down Brendan Lane and see people mowing their lawns and going about their day-to-day lives. This day-to-day living has included new technologies such as Zoom conferences, not only with family and friends, but also with parish staff and even diocesan personnel. I have been on countless number of webinars that are offered on various topics. Webinars to keep the parish going, and webinars for own personal enjoyment. So this has been one world, the day-to-day stuff of keeping relationships in check, keeping the parish and the school thriving, and keeping myself up to date and disciplined and thriving as well. And then there is this other world that I seem to have found myself in over the past couple of months or so. And that's the world of what's going on here in church. You know, for 2 months or more, I will come every day to this place and offer Mass, usually by myself. I will do liturgy of the hours. I would do pray the rosary, pray before the Blessed Sacrament, spend some quiet time before the Lord. And in this world, I have to say that yes, I was by myself, but I was not alone. In this world, I was able to bring with me all of you, and actually the whole parish, my family, my friends, those living and those who have gone beyond in faith. They were all here in these past couple of months, and all here even now, believe it or not. Those who are This is the reality of this Catholic world of ours. Now, if you were to ask a muggle in Harry Potter what they thought about Hogwarts, the school, you would probably get the question, what are you talking about? If you were to ask a hobbit back in the Shire what they thought of Sam fighting off the tortured, wrecked, preciously possessed Gollum, you would probably get the question, what do you mean? And maybe some of you are saying the same thing. What exactly are you talking about, Father? Well, I have to say, there is a whole other world that is going on. And some are aware of this world, and some are unaware of this world. Some completely accept this world, and some live in complete denial of this world. Even before the pandemic, even before COVID, I would see it. Parishioners on Brendan Lane who never come to Mass, and yet on a Sunday, they have their God out, called the lawnmower, eating their grass to manicure perfection. They're living in a different world. And actually, we see this in Scripture. The Israelites wanted to give into this kind of world where they worshiped a God that ate grass, a golden calf, until Moses himself comes down the mountain to offer them the law of God and offers to them a bit of his wrath as well and said, this is not our God. Our God is not a God that eats grass. This is not the God who saves and sets us free. But for those of us who are here, and for those of us who long to be here, we know this world of God, and we know that this world never stopped existing these past couple of months, and this world will never stop existing, this world of our Catholic faith, this world of the Eucharist. We believe leads to eternity. Even in this time of shutdown, this time of separation, this world of our Catholic faith has drawn us all in, whether we know it or not, whether we believe it or not, whether we felt it or not. This world has drawn us all in and drawn us into everything that is real. We hear from people all the time, at least I do, I even said in my younger days, I just need to be in the real world. I just need what's real. Well, theologians have said that what we are doing right now, being in this Eucharist, being here at Mass, theologians have called this moment what is really real. It is here that we learn to tune our ears to the sound of God's voice as we listen to his sacred word to our ears and to our hearts and to our souls. It is here that we learn how to treat each other as God's creation with dignity and respect as we genuflect and bow and as we pray for each other and sometimes as we're even incensed with great honor. It's here that we encounter what the extent of love and a real love will go for our lives. A love that will go to a cross that goes all the way through to the resurrection. It's here that God feeds us, not with ordinary food, but with everything that he has. His own flesh, his own blood, his own soul, his own humanity, his own divinity, all of it. Not holding back anything. God feeds us with his life. Eventually, Moses' predecessor, Joshua, had to ask the people, what world are you going to live in? He said, whom will you serve? And he proclaimed, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Jesus, in the gospel that we just heard, proclaimed, he doesn't dumb anything down. He doesn't water anything down. He doesn't say or use the words kind of, sort of, or drink my blood. This is where we as Catholics proclaim the real presence in the Eucharist that we celebrate in this moment. This gospel that we just heard became a source in which many of Jesus' disciples simply walked away and said, "No, thank you. I don't want to live in your world or what your world is offering." And Jesus was offering food that would help them to live forever in peace and love and friendship and goodwill. He was offering food that would help them to truly live what is really real. And yet some chose another world altogether. So how about you? Sitting here in the pew or listening from home, how about you? What world do you live in? What is really real to you? Well, to get an answer, step into this Eucharist once again and allow Christ to nourish you, strengthen you, and to have the eyes and the heart to see this world, God's world, not hidden and anonymous, a world to accept and not deny, but to see this world, God's world, alive and abundant. And so as a family of faith, we stand and we profess that faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. And so with our trust in the Lord, let's offer our prayers to him.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For the church throughout the world, in our nation, in our parish community, that the radiating power and mystery of the Holy Eucharist will draw all people into the saving life, death, and resurrection of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our world leaders, our government leaders, our state leaders, that what they give witness to will reflect God's laws to care for each other, especially those most vulnerable in our midst, the unborn, children, the poor, the unemployed, and the elderly. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are gathered here in church today, and especially for those who still observe the Day of the Lord from home and through video, that their prayers and their intentions will be joined to the sacrifice of the Mass. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and suffering, for all medical personnel, for those who protect the safety and welfare of all citizens, may they begin be given healing and hope, strength and endurance for all that comes their way. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace in our times, over racial tensions, tensions in the home, tensions caused by anxiety and sin, may Christ's presence step into our world and to bring forth the new reality of God's kingdom. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died this past week from our parish, especially Pat Sarver, and for those whom we remember at Mass this weekend, Mark Furco Jr., Kathleen O'Grady, and Pat Kennedy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious and Grant your church, O Lord, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace, whose signs are to be seen in mystery, in the offerings here present, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For at the Last Supper with his apostles, establishing for the ages to come the saving memorial of the cross, he offered himself to you as the unblemished Lamb, the acceptable gift of perfect praise. Nourishing your faithful by the sacred mystery, you make them holy, so that the human race, bounded by one world, may be enlightened by one faith, united by one bond of charity. And so we approach the table of this wondrous sacrament, so that bathed in the sweetness of your grace, we may pass over to the heavenly realities here foreshadowed. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we with all the hosts of angels cry out, and without end we acclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom of our Lord,
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy of your but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
For communion today, instead of Deacon Bob and I going out to all of you, we're going to ask that you come forward to the altar, since it is the feast of the body and the blood of Christ, to come forward to the altar. Deacon Bob will be at the location down here in this aisle. I will be in this location here in this aisle. If this side can come up first, and then this side, and then if this side can come up first, and then this side, that would be helpful. The marks on the floor, you don't have to step on them. They're just indicators for social distancing. This is just to kind of get us back into Grant, O Lord, we pray, that we may delight for all eternity in that share in your divine life, which is foreshadowed in the present age by our reception of your precious body and blood, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
This coming week, we have on Friday the Feast of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, and so to commemorate this feast and also to offer thanks to God for the reopening of church, and just for an ongoing prayer in this time of the pandemic, we are going to offer a holy hour here in church on Friday from 7 to 8 o'clock in the evening. So check the bulletin for details. So that's this Friday, the Feast of the Sacred